My name is Neependra Khare, and we are here for the session on security consideration while deploying the containerized application. So I'm assuming that you are aware of containers a bit, right? And using Docker, right, at least. And how many of you are using Kubernetes? At least heard about, okay, most of, I mean, some of you are using it. Or some of you would eventually reach there because that's going to be the destination, what we are seeing as a trend now. So if you're not there, you'll eventually going to use in Kubernetes, either knowingly or unknowingly even. That's what I would kind of say. Quick intro about myself, I run a company called Cloud Yuga, and we provide consulting and training around containers, Kubernetes, and so on. I'm also a CNCF ambassador. CNCF is the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, which currently owns and hosts Kubernetes project. I have a course on edX on Kubernetes. It's a free course, you can take it. Before starting Cloud Yuga 3.5 years back, I worked for Red Hat for around 6 years, and then 5 years in some between different startups there. And I also ran a Docker meetup group here in Bangalore for more than 5 years. And just kind of before we start, how many of you are developers or sysadmins? Any sysadmin? Okay. No managers, right? Okay. Managers are there. Okay. Fine. So we'll just quickly look at what is a container image is made of, and then we'll kind of try to relate two things, and then I'll tell you the consideration what you might take it up. So any container image, for example, if you say I'm going to use a container image of Ubuntu, Fedora, or any of distribution, what happens is that particular distribution image contains a base container image. So when you say I'm going to use an Ubuntu container, we kind of say that we're just going to use the user space component of that distribution, not the kernel part. So in containers, you don't kind of deploy the distribution kernel along with the container. Your container just contains the user space component of that distribution. We would then deploy, put our application along with the application dependency, like its runtime, its whatever libraries it requires. And then we can kind of make a container image. And that container image, we can go and run on a container host. So for example, I could have an image for my Python application or Java application. That application I'm going to go and put onto a host where I can run containers. Now this container runtime, it can be Docker, it can be anything. So there is a standard now for container runtimes. It is called as Open Container Initiative. It has specification using which you can define, or there's a set of rules are there that a container image would run, would have a specific format, and it would run by the container runtime, which would have a specific format. So I could build an image with Docker, but I could take that image and run it on some other container runtime, for example, Rocket or RunC or whatever. So, and then I'm going to deploy that runtime on the Docker on a host. That host can be again Windows, Linux, or Mac. And then because that image would have the precompiled or whatever, the everything what you need, you can deploy one or more containers of the same type on that container, on that host, which has a container runtime. Now, you are going to have the orchestration eventually, where you would deploy these applications on a cluster. So here what you see is we have three different hosts, and we kind of bound them together with a software called Kubernetes, which is an orchestrator. Similarly, there can be other ones as well, like Docker Swarm, Marathon, or whatever. But what I'm trying to say is you have taken an image, you have built a container, then it can deploy on a host, then eventually you would have a cluster in which you have kind of put multiple nodes together. Now these nodes can be a VMs or bare metal, and once they have a cluster, then you can deploy containers, and then they would be able to communicate to each other. This is a very kind of very small, I mean, kind of quick intro about the container world. Any questions so far? Okay. So now let's talk about what we can do when we deploy the applications on the cluster, and then what kind of security consideration we can take. First of all, that image what you are building, that image need to be scanned regularly. So today you might have built an image with some software. For example, you have taken the bash version of XYZ today, and then tomorrow you get that heartbeat and their bug and so on, right? Then you need to kind of make sure that when the image is run on the third day or fourth day, it is being scanned for the vulnerability what has been detected a few days back, whatever. So you need to kind of scan those images at regular intervals. So there are software. So I'm assuming that you know about Docker registries or image registries like Docker Hub or any other like Artifactory or wherever you want to put a Docker images there. Now those images or those softwares have inbuilt a scanning mechanism. So either you can use their scanning mechanism to scan the images, or you can use the software like Twistlock or Sysdig and so on, which can scan your images and give you a result or to your ops team saying that okay, this is a vulnerability there. Then you need to kind of make sure that what image you are using, it is being signed, it is being built by the right person. So what you can do is you can sign the images, and those images would have a signature saying that okay, this image is really built by the person whom I trust. And then you're going to kind of execute that. And then again, as I mentioned, software like Sysdig and that Twistlock, they will give you a compliance and audit report of that image, for how good is that image, is where it is being used in an environment, and then you kind of fix them. Well, this is not a security per se, but you need to make sure that your image size, what you are going to use, is minimal. So for example, here's an example. We have a Docker file using which we are building images. So here you see that I mentioned about slash there, but that in the from first line, but it's not actually a real syntax. It says that either node colon 10 image as the base image or node colon 10 hyphen alpine. So there are two different images are there. So like two different Docker files. And as you can see, the second image which I use Docker node colon 10 hyphen alpine, the overall image size is just 70 MB. And if we have used the other one, it is like 673 MB. So while you're building your Docker or the container images, make sure that you kind of, you know what base image you are using. Don't just pick up any image and start building it. It might create some problems. So just to make sure that you kind of do that, because the lower the surface you have, the better for security. Other than just kind of having a big image and then you kind of scan everything. So your transport time, your scanning time, everybody would kind of come to that, right? That's something you need to kind of take care. Similarly, when you are running a Docker program with your Docker containers or any container in general, what you can do is by default, if you start a container, inside the container, the user is root. So for example, if I kind of quickly show you there. So I am on a machine here which has Docker installed, and if I run a container here, just to kind of show you that. So as I run the container, my ID is root. So I am kind of logging into the container as the root user. Hopefully the font is, this font is okay now, the backside. Can you see the fonts? Yeah, so here you can see that the UID and the GID. So what I did in the previous step is I just started a container with just this command. And now in this container, if I look at the ID, this ID is like a root user. So, I mean, though you are inside the container, I'm not exposed to the outside world now. But as I'm in the container, I'm still a root user. So it's a good practice when you are building your image. So here the image is alpine. So what I could do is when I'm building my Docker image or the container image for my software, I could add a user there. And then when I'm executing my particular program, because I mentioned that syntax called user app runner, the eventual Python program is going to run with that app runner instead of the root user. So that way, even if somebody kind of comes to your container, you'll not have the access of a root. Though you still have a layer of a host system there, but it's a good practice to use some non-root user to run your application. Hopefully it makes sense. Any questions? Okay. So this is like when you're building an image, and as I mentioned that while running the container, if you run it, it is going to, currently is coming like this, but if you have used that option in your Docker image, and if you build it, it will not run as a root user. But you can also kind of, I think there is a command in the Docker container, run help. If you look at the help, it will have an option of UID and GID, like a user string here, right? For example, if I say like user, similarly I could do like this, instead of kind of putting and breaking into that image, I could say user and say 1000 maybe, right? And if I look at ID, now if you look at my ID has changed from root to 1000, right? So my user, what I'm running it is not a root user anymore. Similarly, in terms of Kubernetes, when you deploy your application on Kubernetes, this is in a manifest of a pod definition. I'm assuming that you know at least a bit of Kubernetes, but it's not that problem. So a pod is a collection of one or more containers, and think about it's a container for now only. So if you're deploying on Kubernetes, you can again, the example I gave you for Docker, similarly while you're running on the Kubernetes, you can kind of go and specify run as user and run as the group. So that way your program also run as the non-root user there. No. Root user is fine on the host system. What I'm talking about is, so what happened right now? See this command. What does this command does? This command started a container. See, I am on the system. I am on the root. Right. This is the root of the my VM. But and as I run this command, I am running the command to start a container as a root user. Now, but I am inside the container now, and in the container, my ID is 1000 now. So for example, if you're running an application in a container, somebody hacks the application, he comes here. So for that particular user, the UID will be 1000, not be a root user. Sorry? Oh yeah, I haven't changed that, right? I haven't changed it. I wouldn't say that, I could change it, right? Like I mentioned the UID from the GID also. Sorry? No, it's not like that. See, see, generally, if a hack or somebody comes to your application container or VM, right, what he can do, whatever the permission that user might have as a program they are running, right? So now if I'm going to take away, like, for example, if I take away the GID also, right? I mean, I'm just giving an example here, right? It's not that I just want to make sure that the group is also 1000, right? So I don't know whether GID, what something would be there. Yeah, so we need to check the option there. But anyway, we can try with the Kubernetes world and then I can show you there maybe. So I'm going to show you a demo with our platform where we deliver training, but that's not I want to kind of focus on. So this is I'm going to just show you a few demos there which I was mentioning here. So for example, here is the lab we have for the running as a non-root user. So I'm going, this is the same thing what I mentioned earlier. This is the UID, GID, sorry. So here we have an example of the Kubernetes thing. And as I execute this one, I would run a pod, which is a Kubernetes pod. And if I'm going to exec into the pod, and now if I do, it's still starting, I believe. Yeah, still creating. Let it create. So what we're saying is, once we log in inside the containers, if somebody comes to your container, and he would not be able to do any of the root operations. For that particular user, he could just do what a user can do if that hack happens to your application. Make sense? This is not about the root of the system, like it's about the app, the container in which you are running and what's there. So let's just, I'm inside that now. And if I do PSA, UX or the ID, whatever. So you would see that now the programs are running as the user 1000. So that's not a root user for that one. So they cannot do a, like a much of a trouble to us. That's a good practice to have where you're not running your application as the root user there. Another thing you can do is you can mount your file system in the read-only mode. So when you're deploying your container, you can say this particular container root file system would be in the read-only mode. So that even if somebody comes in, they'll not be able to write anything, right? So they'll not be able to kind of do anything. So again, this you can do the same thing at the level of Docker, and similarly you can do at the same level of Kubernetes. So where it's specifying that your root file system in a read-only mode, so that it does not kind of a security risk there. But if you mount a volume inside that, that volume would be writable. So your application can write the content into the volume. So you have an application which might be sharing a shared volume. That volume would be writable, but your host system's root file system is in the read-only mode. You can't write anything there. So let's quickly see the demo of that as well. Yeah, I think we can just quickly see that and then continue from there. So I'm just saying that mount my system as a read-only mode. This is similar for Docker or any Kubernetes or any container container orchestration there. There would be something which would be like that. So we'll just wait for it to get started there. That's one. How many of kind of believe that if a root user can do everything? Can you believe that? A root user, if I say ID 0, that would be able to do everything? How many of you say yes? Anywhere on the whole system also. If I'm saying that if I can see my ID 0, I should be able to do everything, anything. Super user can do everything? Okay. So that's good to know. Let's just see that in action. So let me just kind of finish the previous one. We are inside the pod of the container, and if I do touch that file, you can see that it's a read-only file system. That way I kind of made my file system only the read-only there, right? Okay, so what we are saying is a root user can do everything. That's generally kind of assumption we have. So again, I am on a system where I have Docker installed. Now I'm going to run a container again as the last time, but before that, let me show you a few things so that it makes sense. So I have I have a host system which has some network interfaces attached to it, right? Now if I run if config command and kind of what does this command do? I just want to make it this particular interface to up. If you kind of run that command, this is going to create an alias network interface for me, ETS0:1, and that's the IP will be given to it. So if I do if config, you would see that on my system, I would have one more interface called that ETS01 with that IP. This is like an alias thing which I have given there, right? Now, I mean, you can think of any command there, right? Now I'm going to go to a container where I'm going to use an option called network is equal to host. What this command does, any guess? Sorry? With this command, if I start a container with this particular command, the container shares the same network stack of the host. So if I do if config inside the container, you would see that my container has the same interface as the host. Correct? So this looks perfectly fine. I have an ETS01 interface inside my container there. Correct? And what is my ID? My ID is root. Which means if I could do, now I'm a root user, I have the interface of the host inside the container, and if I do if config ETS0:1, let's say bring it down, and now you say it's going to fail. It is failing. So my ID is root. I have the network stack of the entire host system, but still I can't do it. Now, why is that so? In Linux, there's something called as capabilities. Capabilities is like a group of permissions which makes a what a super user can do. So if I look at the help of man capabilities, this is like you are dividing the super user permission into subgroups, and then you can take out and take away that groups as you kind of go and run and program from there, right? So what we are seeing here is these are the different groups are available to us. And for example, why I'm talking about this particular group, for example, if I'm starting a container or maybe without a container also. So let's take an example maybe. So here is an example of, let's say, CH1, which makes your, you can do a CH1 change ownership of a file or something like that, right? Now, assuming that you are running a program as root, so you log in the system as super root, everything is there, but then you fork a program. Forking means creating a new process, right? And in that process, you can see, you can tell what kind of permission you can give to that particular new program. And there you can take away or give CH1. So even that program would be a root user but can't do the CH ownership change. So let me see a demo of that. That will make much more sense. So I'm going to give an example here where I'm going to do like this. So I'm running the container with the option of call capability drop call net draw. Okay. Now see, I am the root user. I have the entire host system thing. And what I can't do is, I can't even ping the internet. It says me, are you a root? While my ID is root. So a root user, when you say ID root, is not actually like it can do everything. So there are groups given to that thing, and you can kind of, unless you have the complete group, you are not a super root or super user, what you say in general. So this way you can kind of control what kind of things containers can do by default. So like, for example, because I could not change the that ifconfig, right? That command field, right, for us? Ifconfig ets0:1 down. This command failed to me because I don't, so when you start Docker or Kubernetes, they don't give you this permission that you can change the network of a from the container itself. But they could give away. So for example, similarly, if I run a container now with an option called privileged mode. So I'm starting another privileged mode now and with the same option now, but now this command would work. Now because of privileged mode, I have given everything to that particular container. So you need to be careful that, okay, when you are running a container, for example, if you just download a YAML file of Kubernetes of the Docker from the internet, and if you're in the program with the privilege flag on by mistake, and if that program was supposed to be a kind of a hacker or whatever, they're going to rule complete your system. So when you're deploying containerized application, make sure that you're not putting this privilege flag on either with Docker or with Kubernetes as well. So we have an example of Docker now. So while deploying the with Kubernetes, you can kind of defer that privileged option there. So you can have these option here where you can kind of say disable my privileged mode escalation and so on. So with that, we can kind of control that how the application is deployed and can it kind of switch its permission from one user to the other level and so on. So I'm just giving you a few examples here using which you can kind of build a security, whatever, the guidelines for you. So generally what will going to happen is in your dev, QA, and ops cycle, dev, they can do anything in general. Ops is, QA is also fine. But when application goes to production, there need to be some kind of a checks which has to be performed. And these are some of the checks which you have to be done. They can be done manually like we are doing right now, or then there are some kind of a benchmark that tools are available which can help you out to kind of do these kind of checks, saying that you are not kind of opening up this for the world there, right? What about this one? When you deploy your any cluster or orchestration there, you can create the partitioning in the same cluster. For example, it's an example of Kubernetes. Same thing you can apply for other orchestration also, in which we would have different groups or different teams working on the same cluster. So here we have like a teams here, like a QA team and a production team, and each can have their own namespace. Namespace means like a project. So you have a project one, project two. Now what you can do with project, you can kind of, first of all, talk about security. You would also kind of control that how much consumption of resources they can do. So you can say, okay, how much consumption I want to give per namespace. You can set the quota limits on each namespace based on the object count, based on the CPU memory count and so on. So you can put those kind of details per namespace, and that way you can control that, how much consumption each namespace can do. On a further line, what you can do is, you can, so we have now, assume the containers or the pods are there and different namespaces are there. Now, you might consider, we might say that, okay, if though I have a namespace in the same cluster, so I have a cluster of 10 nodes, I have given 2 nodes for my dev, 2 for QA and the rest for the production. So out of 10, this is my dividation is there. Now, you don't want to kind of say that, okay, QA just by mistake comes to the ops machine and so on, or ops container and so on. So what you can control there is, you can control with the help of network policies and say how the containers can communicate to each other, or the pods communicate to each other. How would you kind of put a role there? So for example, here what we are doing is, here we have two namespaces. One is the namespace called default, second is production, or whatever you can call it. And in this production namespace, we have a namespace pod called pod X. But there's something called as app is, there's a label given to it called app is equal to front. That's kind of a label we have given there. Now what we are saying is, this particular pod can only be accessed if the pod has the app is equal to black label and it belongs to default namespace. So I could completely control that who can come and communicate to me. It's called network policies. Similarly, the other pod, if it tried to, is going to fail. The network policy would say, you don't qualify for this particular thing, so that you cannot come and connect to us. So when you deploy a containerized application, you can, network policy you can put in, and with that you can say who can come and communicate to me. Any questions here? Yeah, I'll talk about that. Yeah, I'll talk about that at the end. Any other questions? Okay, this might be okay. That's okay. Then we'll talk about authentication and authorization in the cluster. What happens is, like, I mean, good example of Kubernetes, but it can be applicable for any containerized orchestration you would be going to use. So you're going to have these objects there. That is actually your containers, your applications, your names and so on. And then you would have a user. That user would be accessing those objects. Like, for example, if I run the kubectl get pods or get nodes command, right? For example, if I kind of go to my app here. So here I have kubectl get pods command. Now here I'm listing my pods, right? Now this kubectl is nothing but a user is kind of running a command there. So the user talks to the cluster and then try to access the objects. Now this particular thing between your user to the cluster happens in three stages, which is called authentication, means a user can log into the cluster. Authorization means what a user can do in my cluster. And then eventually we have some further rules and the validation check. Only then a user can access my objects of Kubernetes. Now, I'm talking about this one. So there are two kinds of users we have. One are the normal users like us, like we are trying to run a command. Then there is one more user type called service accounts. Now, these accounts are very, these users are very kind of a unique. These users, think about, these are your programs. So for example, you want to have an UI for Kubernetes. Think about just in a broader case. You have, want to have an UI for Kubernetes where you want to tell your user go to this UI and perform some operations. Now, that UI need to access the Kubernetes cluster behind the scene. For that, we create service accounts. So these are the users which connects to your cluster behind the scene, perform some operations. So when you create these service accounts user, you need to be very careful that what they can do in the cluster. You just kind of don't suggest, okay, again, if you kind of download a YAML file or a manifest file from the internet and try to run it, they might have the permissions that can kind of just destroy your cluster or kind of whatever it is, right? So you need to be careful about them. Like here, I'm giving you an example here. So what we do for that is authorization there. Authentication, a user can log in. I'm not going to talk about that right now. Authorization means that what a user can do in my cluster. Like here, what I'm doing, talking about the specifically for the role-based access control roles there. So what we have here is, in Kubernetes, we have these objects. Like the objects I mentioned about pod, right? So for example, here, I have an permission called pod, right? Get pods are there, any which has seen it. Now, is my user is able to remove the pods, kind of delete the pod, scale the pods or whatever. For example, I am the root user currently, and I could actually go and delete a pod here. So I could say delete pod and the pod name. So I have a permission of creating the pod, removing the, of deleting the pod as well. But what you can control as an orchestration there, that what a user can do in my cluster. Does he list the pods? Can he create the application? Can he scale the application? All this thing is configurable. So what do you see here is something like that. So what we are saying here, I want to have these resources for that user. And that user should be able to do get, list, watch, create and update. He cannot do delete in the sense. What we are example we are giving here. And this particular role is given to a namespace. We talked about namespace earlier. Namespace is a way to partition the cluster what you have. A project there, right? So what we are saying, apply this particular role on the Cloud Yoga namespace there. And then once we have the role created, we can give it to a user. And then we can tell what a user can do in my cluster. Hopefully it makes sense. Any questions here? So we are creating a role and then giving the permission to a user that what he can do. Any questions? Okay. So let's just go ahead and see an example of that. So I already created a user here before kind of starting the labs there. So we just look at the example of the RBAC rule there. So I have finished all that. So yeah, we're creating a role now. So I'm going to execute this command. This is going to create a role for me. So I'm creating a role. So I already have a namespace here. So if I look at the namespace here in my cluster, I have a project like Cloud Yoga default. These are my projects are there. So I'm going to execute this command and this would create a role. And with this role, I have a role now. The next step is for me, I have to do a role binding there. So I would say with this role, bind to a user group or service accounts. So you can kind of bound a role to a given users there. So here I'm going to bind it to my user called Neependra, but this user can be a service account user, which means a program of yours. So a program can be given a role. So here we are giving a role that deployment manager. This is my name was there, deployment manager. And I'm giving that deployment manager role to my user Neependra for my namespace Cloud Yoga there, right? So let me just do that. So I'm going to do the role bindings as well. And now with the next command, I'm going to deploy my application here. So just to kind of quickly tell you the thing now. So for this particular cluster, I have two users. One is an admin user and one is the Neependra user. So currently, as I'm running the command, as the root or the admin there. But when I run this command, here I'm changing the context. Context means I now want to run the command with the Neependra user, a different user there, right? So as now I run this command, now because my user now have the permission to create the pods, because as you can see, we mentioned that I could create a pod. I could do a pod creation or a deployment creation. So let me do that, pod creation. Here, and then I should be able to list the pod because I am passing this context at the runtime. So I'm kind of running this command as a Neependra user there. So I could list the pods, but let's try to list or let's have to remove this pod now. So if I do a delete pod now, we check in the last step, delete pod and the pod name. Now you would see this is going to fail because as per my role, we have not given it. So what's going to happen in a larger company, you're going to have an operations team. They're going to manage the clusters and then they're going to give the configuration file per user. And the per user, what you get as a developer, you'll get a config file using which you can connect to a specific cluster on a specific namespace, and on that namespace you would have a specific permissions. So your operations team is going to kind of control what the complete your policies are going to be, and then per user would be responsible, can do only thing on a specific namespace and only specific options there. Hopefully it makes sense. Any questions? No? Okay. Especially to Kubernetes, you can do auditing there. So you can kind of look at the what happened, when it happened, who did it, and so on. So you can enable the auditing in Kubernetes, or it would be possible for any other orchestration also, where you could look at that audit APIs, where you can answer these questions like who logged into my cluster, what they have done, and so on. So you can kind of get an audit trail there, which would kind of help you to audit and system and see what's happening there. What you have once you are running your applications. So for example, you might have a backend application and a frontend application. Frontend talk to the backend, and that communication would require some password authentication there, right? For that, you can use a object called secret. The secret object, you can kind of pass those credentials as you kind of use those applications. So for that purpose, you can use secret object there, using which you can pass the credentials, TLS or Docker registry passwords. So for example, you might have a private registry where you have images in the private mode. While running the application, you want to provide the credentials and then pull the image. So for all that purpose, you can kind of create different kind of secrets, and then you can kind of pass those credentials and manage them better. Then there are these benchmark tools are there, which you can use. So benchmark tools are like, so there's something called a CSI benchmark. So if you heard about CIS benchmarks. Yeah, CIS benchmark. So CIS is the center of internet security, and they kind of release the benchmark for different things. For example, Amazon Linux, AWS, Tomcat, or whatever. So these kind of, they release the benchmarks against these particular cloud providers or software, whatever, like CentOS, right? So similarly, they have the CIS benchmark for Docker and Kubernetes. What you can do is, they are very simple, like you can download the benchmark and then you can run it against your cluster, and it can tell you what kind of works and what not. So there is something called as Kubebench from Aqua Security. So Kubebench is a software company has built, called Aqua Security. This is an open source tool. They have built for this CIS benchmark of Kubernetes. So what you can do is you can kind of download this Kubebench tool, and you can then run it against your cluster this is for Kubernetes, but even for Docker also you can get it. So you can execute this command, and this is going to give you the output what I was showing you earlier, like pass fail like this. So then you can kind of go and find out the actual error. For example, fail happened, it will have a description. You can go to the CIS benchmark, find the exact definition of that one, and you can then rectify it on your cluster and so on. So you can kind of run these benchmarks regularly interval, and it'll get a general report for you.
So you have Docker.
Yeah, for Docker and Kubernetes both, you have these benchmarks. The Docker bench, I'm not sure what software is, it's paid or free. Aqua Security has released maybe they might have a Docker bench also. But what you can get from here is, so they also have, this benchmark also have some scripts are there, but they are mostly like a problem statement, what solution you have to perform and those kind of things. This is going to give you this one, but if you kind of course, I think if you're going to buy their whatever the subscription of that one, right? For example, if you go to the Docker only, right? you can download the report, and then I think there somewhere I saw they kind of, you can get the details are here. Yeah, so click on this one. So they have all these benchmark kit and so on, and they'll kind of give you. It's like depending on the level what you have, but these benchmarks are very stable. I mean, this kind of a standard there. So you need to rectify them. Either rectify them via writing a script or whatever. But you need to kind of so Kubebench is an open source for Kubernetes. For Docker, I don't know actually, is it free or not? Or there will be some other guys might have it. Yeah, yeah. So they have, right. For example, if you look at the Docker one, right, they kind of giving you for Docker 1.6, 1.11, whatever. What are the community? Of course, it will be for a specific version there. That's true. So Docker is for Docker daemon perspective. So Docker API is common, either you run on Windows or on Mac or wherever, right? So it's like mostly for Docker daemon per se. So, but yeah, you will find for Windows, I don't know whether they have Windows or not, but these are the benchmarks they work actively on. And there is a chapter in Bangalore also, which kind of manages or part of the thing as well. Okay, any questions? We still have 2 more minutes. Yeah, so again, there are paid software, as I mentioned, about TwistLog and then Aqua Security. So these are some companies which kind of provides you this one. So again, as I mentioned about Kubebench, this is an open source tool which you can execute. That's one. Second thing is, if you kind of buy their paid product, they'll kind of tell you exactly what your kind of problem you're having to have and how to rectify it. And third way is, you don't manage this cluster and everything on your own. You buy the managed services from like AWS or Google Cloud, where they would manage all the control plane for you. Everything like there's a company called Nirmata. They kind of gives you, a managed Kubernetes, not managed Kubernetes. So they will help you to install the Kubernetes cluster on your cloud provider, but they will manage the cluster for you. Security wise, they will do all the testing for you and everything. So I can just give the link for those guys if you're interested. So Nirmata. So Nirmata is a company which kind of gives you that thing that you can kind of go and do that.
I have one question here.
That's there. And then last, I just want to open up my company website. Any questions?
Yeah,
of course. Of course. That's the whole idea. Yeah. Yeah. Clare is a similar tool, which is going to be image scanning. So it's mostly for you have a registry. You deploy a Clare tool. It gives you the vulnerability per image what you have there. No, not. Yes, ACD can do. Yeah. It's just but Clare is a tool only for the image only. It does not do the everything for you. So there are, as I mentioned, multiple parts are there, right? Running the container and then running a cluster and so on, right? For the application image only, Clare can help you, but only for that only.
My question is,
So so CNCF has the two such CNCF that I mentioned runs the Kubernetes now, and they have the standard certification there called. I'm just going to finish, and then the CK and CKAD. That's what I was saying. Yeah.
You talk about secrets, right?
Sorry.
A secret object.
Yeah.
So where do we store those secret objects?
So those objects. Oh, that's a good question. So there are two places you can store it. One is there is a key value store in Kubernetes called etcd, right? So you're deploying an orchestration. When you deploy a secret object, those get inserted into that key value store in Kubernetes cluster. So if you are aware, let me just quickly bring up a Kubernetes slide maybe. Introduction. So here is the architecture of Kubernetes. So there's a key value store which stores all the cluster states. So by default, your key value or a secret object goes there. That's one way of doing it. Or you can integrate with some third-party tools like Vault or Hashicorp Vault, where your secret can go in store and then you can retrieve back and use it in our application.
Okay. And how do we manage the load balancing for this Docker?
Load balancing happening, it happens, yeah. Of what? The application?
application load balancing, yes.
Sorry?
Application load
balancing. Yeah, it happens. I'm not going to talk about Kubernetes now, but it happens. It's all worked.
So is there any tool to handle those load balancing?
Yeah, it's already inbuilt. There's no extra tool required for that. It happens internally. So you'll deploy a load balancer on top of the cluster and handle that.
Would you recommend any tools? Would you recommend any tools?
Any tools?
Yeah.
For what?
To handle the load balancing.
No, it is a Kubernetes inbuilt tool is there. There's a load balancer available. Don't take off time there. We'll talk to me offline. Yeah.
I think that's all the time we have for questions. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay.
Thank you, Neependra.